What is up, everyone? Last week we talked about doing continuous movement in XR, and in this video we're talking about teleportation. So I hope you enjoy, and let's jump into it.
As usual, I'm going to set up an OpenXR VR project. So if you have already watched some of my videos and know how to do that, skip to this timestamp, and I'll see you guys in a minute. If you don't know how to set up an XR rig, I'm gonna go through it really fast here, but if you want a more in-depth video, make sure to check out my introduction to Unity VR. We go to Edit, Project Settings, click on Package Manager, enable Preview Packages, and then we go to Window, Package Manager, Unity Registry, find OpenXR plugin, install that. It'll ask you to restart your project, so just hit yes. It's going to change the input system from the old system to the new system, and we're also going to want to install the XR Interaction Toolkit, and make sure to grab the sample default input actions off of that. Now, back into the project settings, we're gonna go down to XR Plugin Management, check OpenXR Preview, hit the exclamation point, and fix all. Go to Features, and check the device that you're using. So I'm using Oculus, so we're gonna use Oculus Touch Controller. Now your project is set up to use XR, and we can start implementing teleportation. Now before we add our XR rig, we want to go into the assets, samples, XR interaction toolkit, whatever package you installed, and default input actions. And inside of here, we want to add each one of these to our action-based controllers. And now we can finally add our XR rig. So right click in the hierarchy, go down to XR, and add a room scale XR rig action-based. This will go ahead and add an XR interaction manager and an XR rig with a camera offset and a main camera left-hand controller, right-hand controller. Inside of the XR rig, make sure to add an input action manager, and inside of the action assets, we want to drag the XRI default into that. And now, if you played the scene, you'd be able to jump in, and you would see some lines coming out of your hands, and you'd be able to move around your controllers and your HMD. But that's not enough for us. We want to move. So let's add a locomotion system. So right-click on the XR rig, go down to XR, and add a action-based locomotion system. This will automatically come with a teleportation provider and a snap turn provider. Inside of the snap turn, we don't want to use both thumbsticks to snap turn, so we're going to uncheck the left. And the locomotion system is automatically going to find this XR rig, but just to speed up our startup time, I'm going to drag the XR rig over here and set that. Oh, and also make sure your XR rig transform is set to 0. Mine got offset at some point. Now we're actually pretty close to being set up for teleportation. One other thing we need is to add a teleportation area to the location that we want to teleport to. So we're going to select the ground, and then over here in the inspector, add a component, and we're going to search for teleportation area. You get two options here. You can do an area, or you can do an anchor. When you teleport to an area, you can teleport to anywhere on the surface of that object. When you teleport to an anchor, however, it sends you to the anchor point of that object, so to the center, and it adjusts your position and your rotation to that specific spot. So if you want to have your player only be able to teleport to specific locations or very specific areas, then you use anchors throughout your scene. Else, you can just use an area and set the area like you would a nav mesh. For this, we're going to use area, and now you can teleport already. You can teleport by holding down the grip button and pointing wherever you want to go, and if the line interactor is hovering over anything that is a teleportation area, it'll send you there. But the issue is, it's going to keep sending you to that spot even if you hold down the reticle, and this is going to cause some issues, and it's not really the behavior we want to have the player teleport somewhere when they try to grab something. It doesn't really make sense in my head why this would be the default for the teleportation teleportation, so we're gonna make some adjustments. Now, in most games, you're able to teleport by pushing the thumbstick, and that will start the teleportation sequence. So you'll have a line that arcs out and lands and has a reticle that shows you where you're going to teleport to. And the position that you have your thumbstick is also going to be the rotation that you end up when you teleport to that specific spot. And that is completely different than pressing the grip button and being able to hold the grip button and teleport to anywhere on the teleportation area. It's bizarre to me why they coded the default like this. So we're gonna make some changes. First off, let's make the line look a little bit better. We're gonna use the left-hand controller as the primary teleportation controller, and we're gonna use the right hand as the snap turn controller. So actually, we're gonna go into the right-hand controller and just take away the line interactor stuff. So we're only gonna have an XR controller and a transform inside of the right hand. Now, on the left hand, we can go into the XR interactor line visual, and inside of here, we can decrease the width. So I'm gonna go with a 0.01, which is about half the width. And you can also add a gradient to the line and a invalid color gradient. So you can make this transparent on one end and it gets more solid when it gets to the other end, and you can change the color to green or whatever you want. And also there's a width curve, so you can also have your line be smaller on one end and larger on the other. And there is a reticle, and that's going to be what shows up when it hits an object. And one more change we're gonna make is going up to the XR ray interactor, and instead of having a line type being a straight line, we're going to use a projectile curve, and I'm gonna change the velocity down to about 5. That way it's not reaching out and arcing away super, super far. You'll see what I mean when we test it again. All right, let's do some coding now. Go into your locomotion system, and we're going to add a component, and I'm gonna call this teleportation manager. Create a new script, and before we go into the editor and start working on this script, I wanna show you some of the input actions we're gonna be using. So let's go into samples, XR interaction toolkit, package, and the default input action. So inside of your XRI left hand, because that's what we're going to be using, you'll notice that you already have a teleport select, a teleport mode activate, and a teleport mode cancel. The difference between selecting and activating is actually the direction that you press the thumbstick. So you activate it by pushing the thumbstick forward, and then select the thumbstick can be any direction. I played around with this a little bit, and I'm not actually even going to use the teleport select. We're just gonna use this move down here, which is just a primary 2D axis, 2D vector. And that's going to give us the thumbstick position. And I'm actually gonna go in here and select everything for the directions. Make sure you go in here and hit auto save, and then we can exit out of that and start to go into the code. So open up your teleportation manager script. In order to access those actions, we need to call an input actions asset. You may end up having a missing reference for this, so you can auto import it, or you can type in using UnityEngine.inputSystem up here at the top. Now let's grab the activate action, the cancel action, and the thumbstick move action. I'm gonna create a variable. I'm gonna call this one activate. And in order to get the asset, I'm gonna call action asset dot bind action map. And then you type in the name of the action map that you want. So this one is going to be XRI left hand, and then dot bind action. And then again, the name of the action. So this one is going to be teleport mode activate. And then for each of these actions that we get, we also need to enable them. So activate dot enable, make sure you do capital E enable with parentheses at the end. And then I'm going to do the same thing for cancel. And one more time for the move direction, but I'm going to call this one thumbstick just so we can remember what it actually is. And thumbstick we're actually going to want to use later on in the code. And to do that, I'm going to make it a global variable by putting it up here. And then the way I usually code things is I designate global private variables with an underscore in the front here. That's why I'm doing that. All right, so now we want something to happen whenever you activate or cancel a teleportation action. So below the update method, I'm going to create two more methods. One is going to be on teleport activate, and the other is going to be on teleport cancel. And we're going to subscribe to these methods anytime that teleportation is activated or anytime the teleportation is canceled, respectively. And to do that, we say activate.performed, and then we're going to use plus equals, and then the method we want to use on teleport activate. And we do not put the parentheses, and you're going to get an error here. And that's because activate.perform sends a context, and we need to receive that in our method. So I'm going to type that in here. And of course, we're going to have the same issue for the canceled as well. So I'm going to just copy and paste this. And below canceled, we can say cancel.performed plus equals on teleport cancel. Now, anytime this action is performed, this method is going to run. And it's much more efficient than doing this method inside of the update call because it's not running every single frame. It's just only when this action is performed. The next thing we're going to add to this class is the raycast that we're using to tell the game where the player wants to teleport to. We're going to do that the same way by serializing the field. And this is going to be an XR ray interactor. And I'm going to name it ray interactor. And then in the start method, we're actually just going to start out by disabling the ray interactor. To do that, we type in ray interactor enabled equals false, because the idea is to only show the line when you're pushing the stick forward, because when you release, it's going to automatically teleport you. And then when you push the stick forward, it starts the teleportation. And then you should be able to cancel it by pressing the grip button. That's how the process is going to work. Or that's how, at least how it works in my mind. So we know when on teleport activate is called, we want to enable the raycast. That makes sense. So inside of here, we're going to say ray interactor dot enabled equals true. And then we also want the opposite to happen if we cancel ray interactor enabled equals false. That makes sense. Now the tricky part of this is finding out where the position of the raycast is when we release it. So if we tried to grab the position here in the activate method, that wouldn't be the right spot because that's wherever you first started the teleportation, but you haven't finished it yet. And you could start it and then move to a different position and then release. But if we tried to get the position right when it activated, it would just send you back to the first position no matter what. So we don't want to do that. And the best way I've come up to do this is to have a toggle that says, okay, the teleportation ray is active. And then at the very last moment when it becomes not active, that's when we want to grab the position and that's when we want to teleport. And we're going to perform that inside of the update method. So I'm going to create an if statement inside of the update method, and it's going to have a new variable called isActive. I'm going to use my editor to go ahead and create that. So this is running every frame. So if isActive is false, we want the rest of the code to just not even run. So I'm going to blip isActive and then just type return underneath it. So now if it is not active, if the teleportation ray is not active, then we're just going to escape and not do anything. If it is active, we can continue and do code underneath here. But where is this variable actually going to be set? We're actually going to set it down here in the onTeleportActivate method. That makes sense. So we're going to set this one to true if onTeleportActivate is activated. And also don't forget to throw isActive equals false inside of the onTeleportCancel, because when we cancel, we obviously want it to deactivate. So now continuing on in the update method, we're going to actually start to use this thumbstick here. So if the thumbstick is recentered, and in order to check for that, we say thumbstick.triggered. We also want to return. So now we have two conditions. One is if the actual teleport is not active, we're not going to continue. And the second one is if the thumbstick is still pushed forward, then that means that the player doesn't want to teleport yet. So we're just going to leave still. And now at this point in the update method, the thumbstick has been pushed forward. The teleportation has been activated, and then it's also been released. The trigger is back to zero. So thumbstick.triggered is going to be false. So that means that the user now wants to teleport, and so we're going to have to get a raycast and try to get a hit off of it. So this is where we're going to use the ray interactor, and we're going to use a method called getCurrentRayCastHit. And this is going to give us back a raycastHit variable. And we can actually use this as another if statement, just like we did before. It's going to keep doing if statements. And then we'll need to invert this if statement, because if it comes back false, that means that we didn't hit anything. The player tried to teleport to something that doesn't exist. So we're just going to exit. But this one's going to be a little bit different than the first two, because the user has stopped trying to teleport. So we also want to turn off the ray interactor, and we also want to turn isActive off. So we're going to set ray interactor enabled equal to false and is active equal to false. But if it does hit something, we can now use the teleportation provider, which we need to bring in to the code up here. We're going to serialize field private teleportation provider, and I'm just going to call it provider. And then down here, we can say provider queue teleportation request. And then this needs a teleportation request object. So we're going to make that up here, say teleportation teleport request going to be equal to a new request. And then there's four different variables you can put inside of here. There is a destination position, a destination rotation, a match orientation, and a request time. And you don't actually have to fill out all of these. The only one you actually really need is the position. And that position is going to be our hit dot point. I'm not going to do the match orientation or the request time, but in an effort to be transparent, like I really want to be on this channel, I could not figure out how to do the rotation for the teleportation. In my head, it makes sense, and I tried it, and I just couldn't get it to work. So that kind of presents an opportunity for you guys. If you come up with the solution for how to set the rotation using the thumbstick, so when you push the thumbstick out, it sets the position, and then when you release it, I want to be able to rotate towards the last position of the thumbstick. But the issue is, if we tried to get the thumbstick location now, it would always be zero, because we only teleport when the thumbstick is back centered. And so I tried a little bit with getting the last one or last couple thumbstick positions, but I couldn't figure out how to work it. So if someone comes up with an idea of how to do a quaternion here and give me a rotation, I would be forever grateful, and I will do an update video, and I will mention you and give you a big shout out, because I'm learning and you guys are learning, and I think it's best when we all learn together. I don't want to say I know everything and just be this top dog XR guy. I'm learning same as you guys. So if someone comes up with a solution to this, I will do an update video and give you a big shout out. So for the time being, I'm going to comment that out and put a question mark here. And then let's put the request into the teleportation request method. And that should request our teleportation. And then this will check to see, is it a valid teleportation request? If so, it will teleport us. And then at the very end, we want to set ray interactor to false and is active to false. I believe that is everything. So make sure you save. And then we're gonna go back to Unity and go ahead and set these serialized fields. So we need the action asset. We need the ray interactor that's attached to the controller. And then we need the provider, which is in the same component. And now let's test it and see how it works. So you can see when I push my thumbstick down, the ray comes out. And then when I release, I teleport. And then the ray disappears. And then when I push the thumbstick up again, the ray comes back out. And when I release, teleport. And if I try to teleport to something that doesn't exist, so like outside here, I release and the ray interactor goes away. And I don't teleport, which is the exact behavior that we want. From here, you can play around with the line however you want, add a new material, add a transparency, add some particle effects, add a reticle here in the game object spot. Any kind of shape game object will do. You can throw that in here just to make it a little more obvious. Circle of where the user is going to teleport to. There you go. I really hope this helped. And remember my challenge to you. If you figure out how to get the rotation working, then send me a comment or an email, and I will do an update video and give you a big shout out. And speaking of shout outs, there are a couple of people that I am excited to give a shout out to. Tim and Austin are new to the Patreon gang, and it absolutely blows me away that both of them would want to support me and my work with a few dollars every month. So thank both of you, Tim and Austin, for being so supportive. And if you're interested in becoming a Patreon, there's a link down in the description. You will get access to all of the source code from this video and all the previous videos I've ever done. You get the whole project, code, everything. And there's also a couple other tiers where you get exclusive live streams with me, and also any of the games I develop you get access to. So check that out, see if that's something that would interest you. And as always, free of charge, if you guys run into any issues with any of the videos I do, or if you just run into a issue coding or something, just leave a comment below any of my videos and I will respond within an hour or two and try to help you out. I really enjoy doing the one-on-one comments and interactions with you guys, so keep posting comments, and I'll see you in the next video.